Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture, and hopefully the most Renaissance-like manner which arts and culture may be discussed, so please stay tuned for that. Now, I don't know whether I should say hello, Henry, or hello, dear viewer, because I don't know whether I should do this video for just one of my long-time subscribers who... In the video that I think I did just previous to this, in the comment section, this kind of friendly debate turned into, I guess I'd say, a playful wager about certain things, and I just thought that I'd do this video so as to make it official that I accept the general terms of that situation, and that I am, as it were, a man of my words, and I am in a habit of meaning what I say and saying what I mean, and as such, I don't wish to somehow... shake myself loose from the stances that I took, because I took them because I in all seriousness mean them, and that they have the greatest amount of significance in my life. So of course this video may play to some sort of an outside viewer who just happens to stumble onto this, whether right now or at some later point, but I'm just kind of debating whether to talk to Henry in particular, or just talk in general to whomever it may concern. But yes, so... anyway, just to sum up that story thus far, Henry and I were talking about what is the best, or what is a better kind of strategy to have a beneficial impact to the arts and culture scene, such as here in Finland, and Henry took the kind of stance that let's say talk is cheap and action speaks louder than words, and as such, because the cheap talk is in such a diminished category, that's why nothing that happens there should be taken too seriously, and everyone who is serious should go out and you know, be all action, which I won't say that that isn't somehow a laudable, some sort of a general preference for all artists and would-be artists, but unfortunately I had to disagree from the kind of standpoint that I don't think all action is somehow inherently significant action, and I took the kind of stance that it would be better to somehow, as Mahatma Gandhi said, one must endeavor to become the change that one wishes to see in the world. I take that as the kind of main level, and then I take it upon myself to embody the kind of ideal that I have for, let's say, arts and culture. I take it on myself to embody that ideal, and then after becoming that kind of an ideal of, let's say, for the sake of argument, that a certain kind of a Renaissance man who has a certain kind of loving devotion for the field of arts and culture for its own sake, you know, with some sort of a doing things for the love of the game, as it were, rather than thinking that such and such a thing is just a job, and you know, being there just to cash in and so on. So let's say that that's a quickly sketch kind of a general ideal, and then the stance that I take is that it's important to first embody your ideal and then to just gradually expand from there. And basically the idea, which is why I invoked the two people that I invoked as the most significant figures for the French New Wave film movement to be able to exist, I would maintain that the first one is Henri Langlois and the second one is André Bazin. By the way, this is just my personal theory. It's not as if every single human being in the film industry or film culture is in some sort of automatic agreement about who the significant forces are for the French New Wave film movement. So it's just my stance that Langlois and Bazin are the most important. And my argument why they are the most important is because they made decisions that could include others in this kind of field of significance. So basically, François Truffaut couldn't have had a career if André Bazin hadn't taken him under his wings. And André Bazin, in all likelihood, would have been a person outside certain field of significance if Henri Langlois hadn't done things to create a community where people may be united by sharing what they both agree or what they all agree is significant. So that's why that kind of a general framework that Langlois in the biggest way and André Bazin in slightly smaller way were able to create. I think that's what enabled this surge in excitement and the possibilities for, you know, some young enthusiast feeling like they were rediscovering and reinventing cinema by just following their heart and having things made possible. Partly because there were individuals who, let's say, were professionally involved in creating possibilities. So obviously you cannot have a bigger significant culture without all manner of individuals creating opportunities for each other. So, you know, anyone from the producer Beauregard to Jean-Pierre Léaud, the actor, and you know, any amount of people there in between, everyone gets to contribute to the kind of higher culture when the scene is properly made. So there was just this kind of a philosophical difference in what the kind of main level of contribution should be. So Henry took the kind of stance that action is the best paradigm for contribution, and that talk would be a very insignificant form of action, and I don't somehow begrudge him that stance. My angle to the situation is a fundamentally different one. So let's say that I agree that there's a hierarchy to actions, that one style of action is better than or can be better than another style of action. And I guess what I'm saying is that I think the best style of action, the best category of action is one of becoming the ideal and then expanding from there in a manner that I think pretty neatly brings the kind of realistic plane of being for the kind of higher culture. So basically what I'm saying is that I am taking this kind of situation seriously, and I'm using historical models of something that has worked in the past when trying to make the right kinds of moves here in the present. So I'm not just doing things based on what I personally like or what somehow comes naturally for me. I accept the kind of main demand that when existing in the community and in the kind of general culture plane, it is a question of meeting others halfway if you want the kind of shared significance to be a connective element in what is eventually amounting up to a higher culture. So this kind of overlap of formative experiences and habits and preferences and such things, that overlap, I think, is an absolutely integral part in being able to have a culture zone where there's possibilities for long-term growth and a deeper shared significance between individuals in this regard. So what I would say to Henri is that I think that he's not appreciating just how few individuals take the attitude that I'm proposing that Langlois took. In that what I'm saying is that I think the majority of individuals in situations like this would take the attitude that Henri took, in that they think that action is the best paradigm. But the thing that I'm arguing with is that an action may be individualistic. So there's this idea that, you know, the famous philosophical joke that if a tree falls in the forest and there's no one witnessing it, what does it add up to? Or what does it signify? Or did it really happen? Or whatever. But basically this idea that an action doesn't necessarily involve others, and inasmuch as it doesn't involve others, it doesn't necessarily add significance to others, which is why I think that this kind of communal paradigm that I propose is the best one as far as actions with the highest level of significance. That's why I feel like my main attitude is a better one. And it's entirely possible that, you know, when I evoke this kind of a situation from Väinö Linna's The Unknown Soldier, where there's three soldiers who went AWOL, and an officer catches them and sentences them to sentry duty so that they would be dissuaded to do any rogue action. Rogue actions in the future, but a bombing from the Russian side interrupts this kind of disciplinary situation, and the two two, I believe, private first class. The two PFCs in that situation, they think that the start of the bombing should excuse them from the disciplinary duty, whereas it's not really often remarked. I'm not saying I'm the first one to draw parallels between this, but it's interesting that it's celebrated when the character called Rocca, when he refuses the disciplinary action of putting stones flanking a given path that, you know, makes the officers feel like there's some kind of an aesthetic improvement in their field condition, and they get to discipline somebody who they think that is out of line. When Rocca has this kind of disobedience towards what he thinks is a pointless, wrong-headed stance, when Rocca takes a stance against being disciplined, that character is generally celebrated in Finnish culture, but Sergeant Lehto is also being disobedient towards what he perceives to be a fatuous form of being disciplined. Everyone, like, people seem to have double standards towards these two effectively similar situations, and that Rocca's disobedience is seen as stemming from his fundamental reasonableness and his common sense attitude, whereas when Lehto is being disobedient, it's treated as stemming from his fundamental unreasonableness. But if anything, the Sergeant Lehto character, when he opposes the Lammio character, the audience sympathies tend to be against Lammio, when in the Edwin Lainer film version where Rocca is put in that kind of situation where he's against, I believe it's Lammio again, and the character played by Tauno Palo, whose name escapes me right now, it's interesting to note about that, just how the audience has the absolute opposite reactions against the Rocca disobedience or the Lehto disobedience, which structurally seem rather identical situation. But it's just kind of case in point as that Lehto, with his disobedience, he does an action. Whereas when Rocca does disobedience, it's an action, but it's in a different framework. The Rocca framework is one that he has included a greater amount of people into his kind of immediate community. So the reason why audience has goodwill towards the Rocca character is because the audience feels like they are in the same boat with him, versus Lehto, no one feels like they are on the same boat with him, because Lehto doesn't want to feel like he's on the same boat with him. So even though it seems like an insignificant quibbling about what manner is different, you see how there's huge differences in outcome with those kind of insignificant differences in mentalities. So, you know, not to try and prove my own point, but I think that in situations like this, you see just why the kind of greater scope to the mentality can be ultimately the difference between a winner and a loser. I did evoke that scene from The Unknown Soldier, where Sergeant Lehto has the kind of attitude that if the good officer thinks that the sentry duty is so important then surely a little case of aerial bombing cannot intrude on the also important sentry duty. And they just standing there in an extremely dangerous situation where Lehto is basically acting like he's suicidal. And well, if you've read the book or seen the movie, you know the overall situation. But anyway, I evoked that moment from The Unknown Soldier, basically stating that this kind of a path that effectively is an artist's life, then lots of people will tap out when they see nothing but difficulties, nothing but sacrifices, nothing but, you know, slings and arrows of outrageous fortune assailing them from all sides. Lots of people, they feel like those two PFCs in that situation, that why should anyone stay with the difficulties when it's easier just running away? It takes a rare person, even if you're a nicer guy than Lehto is, it takes a very rare person to keep volunteering for the difficulties whilst there are no guarantees of success. So basically, the general path of an artist is that in your starting point, you are, let's say, here, and your presence has a certain kind of an objective reality. There is the what is. When you're starting as just a private individual, you know, it's not a case that you think that you are good enough as you are. What you think is that you can ultimately become the person who's good enough to be a professional artist. Martin Scorsese, when he was 18 years old, didn't think that he was then and there good enough to be an Orson Welles or what have you. But Martin Scorsese thought that he can travel the road into being good enough and into being an insider. So everyone starts as an outsider and they travel into being an insider. But the problem is that when you are here in what is, and you realize that there's some sort of a place of what should be, you need to take yourself from what is to what should be, but there are no guarantees with this kind of investment of time, sometimes money, of energy. Like, it takes years, and quite a lot of people just don't have the time or the energy in disposable form to invest in. So the reason why there are relatively few Martin Scorsese's or William Shakespeare's or Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart's, the reason why there are so few is because that road from the starting point of what is into the what should be, that's a long journey, it's a difficult, like, it's a long journey, it's a difficult journey, and there's different myriad levels to the difficulties, which is why most, either they give up, or either they give up being somehow crestfallen over the main plane of the reality of that kind of artist position. Either it's that, or they just get to a point where they don't know how to go forward. There is some sort of a disconnect. They just see some sort of a emptiness ahead of them, and they decide to call it quits because they don't know what else to do. Basically, what I'm saying perhaps Henry didn't entirely understand this kind of situation, that when you're here at the starting point, here's the finish line. When I talked about this kind of Lehto-esque guard duty, you know, this, like, getting from here to here, the logistical realities are what undo most people. So basically, there's this kind of situation that who has the time and energy to invest in taking the Martin Scorsese path, taking the Wolfgang Mohner's path, taking the William Shakespeare path. You know, most people are rendered ineligible to even try just because of the limitations that reality imposes. And basically, what I suggested as the Lehto mentality is that you will have to coexist with massive amounts of difficulties, and there's no guarantees that the investments and the risks and sacrifices you're taking, there's zero guarantees that you'll get anything as a reward for that. It's a high-risk, high-reward situation, and most people refuse to devote the entirety of their life into such a high-risk, high-reward type situation. So that is the kind of plane where when you are en route between from that original starting line into that finish line of being able to be a professional artist, when you're en route, it is like being either Lehto or the BFC in that kind of the unknown soldier situation. And what I am saying is the Lehto mentality is that the BFCs, they give up, they want to run away because it gets too hot in the kitchen, as it were. Whereas some people, for whatever reason, they will not be dissuaded by the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. They will keep making the investments of time, money, and energy. They'll pour their lives into that kind of endeavor. And, you know, it is a minority of individuals who will even see that kind of journey to its end point. Like, lots of people as if start, but out of the totality of the group that starts, very few are still there standing when it's time to be near the finish line. So basically what I'm saying is that it's already quite a rare achievement when a person signals that there is no possibility of acting like the BFC, of giving up early. That no matter how impossible things seem, no matter what sacrifices and risks have to be taken, no matter what slings and arrows of outrageous fortune are, that somebody will see that thing through and endeavor to be there at the finish line. Whether they're successful or not successful, they will not voluntarily take the premature exit. So that was kind of the main effect of bringing up that Lehto sentry duty situation. Obviously, within the time span of a YouTube comment, I quite simply didn't have the opportunity of going maximally in-depth, elaborating on why it is that I took such a metaphor as I did. I just think that as a mentality and the Langlois nature as a mentality, I think they are kind of the two sides of me doing what I believe is necessary. Saint Francis of Assisi has a famous saying about how to achieve miracles, and the suggestion that he had is that everyone who wants to do something grand should look to what is necessary and do what is possible, and with time and energy they will be able to have done what the prisoners of their own experiences held to be impossible. So basically, the difference in that kind of starting point, where I think that an action in and of itself is still insufficient. What is necessary is that you'll be able to represent, like, if the starting point of what is and the end is what should be, I think that what I am doing fundamentally, it's this kind of Langlois attitude that I'm taking, is that it is this kind of situation of forcing myself to live according to the kind of ideal, looking at what is necessary. So some of the things that are necessary is that that the film industry, for example, that that the next generation would have it in a better shape than they got it in, that they are leaving, that our generation, let's say, that we would leave the industry in better shape than we got it in, and we got it in pretty flimsy shape. So again, this is dealing with what is necessary and doing what is possible. Well, that is then the field of actions, but again, as we were established, different, some actions are better than others. So I'm, you know, when doing what is possible, it is moving with actions that exist in observable reality, but I'm just being, you know, like there's a question of selecting the better actions and rejecting the less good actions. So again, this is a question of looking at what is necessary, doing what is possible, and then again, with time and energy invested, with years, sometimes decades, sometimes multiple people investing all of their lifetime into their vocation, with the entirety of that time and energy, people will be able to have done what the prisoners of their own experiences initially held to be impossible. When they looked at that whole road, when they look at that, the entirety of that scope, when they contrast the difference of what once was into what eventually would become, they think that somebody taking themselves from here to here, that that's impossible, that the scope is too big. But, you know, following the idea of Franciscan pragmatism, you know, when you look at what is necessary, do what is possible with enough time and energy, you will have been able to do what somebody once held to be impossible. That's all that I propose to do. I don't propose to do anything that isn't a possible move. You know, I mean, you can of course think that I have a, like, you are free to think that I would have a, some sort of a lesser amount of moves possible than you might think necessary for this situation. But one of the areas where we differ is that I don't think that the person even needs to do anything wildly out of the ordinary. I don't think it's a question of just somehow reinventing the wheel and, you know, being completely out of this world with stances taken and whatnot. I think that the historical models and just a pragmatic viewpoint of looking at the landscape, looking at what works, looking what the greater community needs, what the greater community wants, and being able to be a bridge, taking people from where they are into where they'd rather be. Like, I think that there's an elaborate framework of simple down-to-earth moves that create that kind of miraculous overall situation, but I don't think that we are dealing with impossible situations of people needing to be some kind of space age geniuses doing things that have never been done before. Quite on the contrary, I think that people should restrict themselves to following the historical models of what has worked and doing things that did work before and rejecting things that there's credible, objective data saying that if you do insert thing, the audience will reject it, the art scene will become more impoverished, and the industry will be in worse shape after such and such a decision. Rejecting what doesn't work, embracing what has worked. I think that's the very simple framework. And I just don't think that there's a single stance that I'm taking is somehow difficult to do or difficult to arrange. Again, there's a very elaborate framework of many things in there, but the connective element that connects one position to another position, those are all built with simplicity and built with things that have worked for sometimes decades, sometimes centuries. I refuse the kind of assessment of my stances being improbable. I think that, on the contrary, I think that everyone else is dealing with improbable outcomes, whereas I look at things from a purely mathematical standpoint, and I look at how it is that you can embrace, if there is this kind of line of looking at what is necessary, doing what is possible, and with time and energy, achieving something initially seemed impossible. When doing what is possible, there is this qualitative assessment contrasting different moves, but I certainly take probability and realism into account with every single situation, and I just resent the idea as if I would be the one dealing with improbable and not properly assessed movements, when I feel like I'm the one merely doing what has already worked and looking at what has what can reasonably be projected to be probable, like comparatively more probable than doing something else. We have slightly different viewpoints apparently, but anyway, so that's just me elaborating on a couple of things said, and elaborating on why it is that I think I can stand a chance in being successful. Because again, if when you look at an 18-year-old Martin Scorsese and then look at say a 40-something Martin Scorsese, he needed to travel quite a journey, and you cannot get to that position if you don't invest yourself in that longer journey. And you already know that I'm investing myself in that longer journey. you just don't realize necessarily just to what an extent, like you don't seem to wish to acknowledge the actual extent of that kind of investment of time, energy, and care in that kind of journey. You seem to act like it's something that I recently started, but really I got an earlier start than just about most, and I feel like I have a greater efficiency than just about any of these other names of people who already crossed the finish line. Not to somehow participate in self-praise, but I do move quickly. It's just the scope of this whole situation, has the distances be so great that even person who moves quickly, like if you walk from Siberia to India or something, like the distances are so great that if somebody looks from, you know, an eagle's viewpoint, no matter how quickly the small dot on the ground is moving, it looks like it isn't even moving, it looks like it isn't even progressing. So again, because the scopes to this kind of situation are just so great, that's why no matter how quick somebody is, it doesn't look like anything, and it's purely a matter of scope. Like, you're welcome to pick an artist at random, any artist, and like go to a point where they're, say, 18 years old. Like when Charles Dickens was 18 years old, how long did it take from that point of what is into him eventually being in the newspaper industry, writing his short stories, becoming a novelist, becoming the most successful novelist in the history of English literature. Like from that starting point of 18 into what eventually was the finish line with all the Great Expectations type books, like the scope was so great that, if you were there, standing there, arms like this, tapping your toes when Dickens was, say, 22 years old, and it looked like he wasn't moving at all. It's just a situation that the scope is so great that you almost, like, you need to skip forward a year entirely to see the progress because of how massive the scale is to be able to somehow effectively move the needle as far as the general community is concerned. So that's why, it's a tough field to have significant contributions, and you need to take that into account when you start, but just saying that when assessing what somebody is, what somebody is doing, the scope perhaps is such that it belies the achievements and the terrain traveled that people have. And I'm just saying it for the record, for whatever that's worth. Now, anyway, that's just kind of general thoughts about this kind of situation. And more in particular, I'm just doing this video to, as it were, make it official and to recognize the kind of stances that Henri took and to somehow defend my own positions, to argue the kind of rhyme and reason behind the stances that I'm taking. And yeah, so since Henri picked the kind of situation that Finnish film industry right now is in a position that neither of us is satisfied in, and then if anyone wants to be a significant person in, say, the Finnish film industry or Finnish culture zone at large, that person should cause some sort of a beneficial change to the situation. And Henri decided that if anyone is to be a significant person, the change that they should have should get the scene from this starting point into a point that is at least the qualitative level of the Svenska film industry under the kind of golden period where Harry Schein, who I believe was an Austrian immigrant who relocated in Sweden, the kind of Svenska film industry under Harry Schein, that that should be some sort of a quality bar, that that Finnish cinema hasn't made any kind of significant improvements if it cannot get over that quality bar. I think that that's an eminently fair stance, in that you know, we don't need you know, crumbs falling from the table, acting like that's sufficient quality. There needs to be some kind of a significant, sustainable tradition of quality. And I feel like picking that kind of Svenska film industry under Harry Schein, that's a realistic, appropriate decision for the Finnish line, in that the scale to which that is happening since it was able to happen in Sweden, it's obviously like actually possible for it to happen since it did happen, and you know, the industrial scope isn't one that's overwhelming. And then Henri picked 80 months for this to happen. And again, I feel like that is fair. Now, I already told Henri that because of certain autobiographical reasons that I don't feel comfortable going in great detail into right now, I personally don't have the luxury of necessarily even waiting that kind of 80 months, which is it's a bit under 7 years. So in 2026, there should be either good times in the Finnish film industry, because some individuals have been able to do something, I mean, there should be some good times in the Finnish film industry by early 2026. So that's the time, I think, again, that's fair, because even though it's a rather difficult, like, I feel like it's neither easy nor difficult. Like, obviously, if somebody would start from zero, that would be a mean timetable, that you'd really need to burn the candle at both ends. Now, I am burning the candle at both ends, and I am taking, I am going rather recklessly through this kind of endeavor of mine. I am doing that, but like, you'd really need to go all in and move at outlandish speeds. If you started from zero, Now, I mean, I've been on this road for well over a decade, so I'm not starting from zero. I'm just well on my way, and I've actually already settled on the kind of total plan that it's just like I've already designed every single step on this plan. Like every single step is linked from one simple move to another simple move to another simple move to another simple move to another simple move. I've already done all of that, so there's no design work that needs to be done. It's simply a matter of moving on the plane of reality in this particular community and being able to start connecting those dots. But anyway, that's why that kind of 2026 timeline, like it's tough considering how unlikely, like the Finnish film scene right now, it's not very likely to have the kind of, let's say, reasonable minor success stories that something like Ingmar Bergman's Seventh Seal or Wild Strawberries were. Like, those are movies that do something on the international level, but it's not as if they're like a $1 billion, you know, releases. So, you know, even though that's a reasonable bar, it doesn't particularly right now seem like the Finnish film industry is in that kind of a situation. But since Henri has been a long-time viewer on this channel, he already knows that I feel like I discovered a certain kind of a secret sauce in classical Finnish, in the history of, or in the golden age of Finnish cinema, in that there were two high-profile French cinematographers working in Finland, Marius Rechy and Charles Boer, and then the composer Georges de Kosinski, Valentin Ivanov, and or in Finland known as Valentin Vaala, and Theodor Tugai, in Finland known as Teo Tulia. Like, there was this high-profile foreign contribution that I think created this kind of a, like, in as much as classic Finnish cinema has some special quality, it's when there was this kind of a rarer tonal plane where you had different kind of individuals from different kind of backgrounds, different kind of traditions be able to contribute to this kind of a more flamboyant, more extensive tonal plane. Like when you look at classical Hollywood, when Hollywood was at its greatest, Michael Curtis came from Hungary, somebody like Max Steiner, I think he was a German, the Epstein brothers, I don't know where they were born, but I would imagine that their, either their parents or their grandparents had some sort of an immigrant situation. Konrad Veidt, Peter Lorre, they had come from Germany. I wonder if Sidney Greenstreet was English, I'm not 100% sure. But Ingrid Bergman, she was from Sweden, and you know, Casablanca, it had this kind of interesting international ambience that could have never been arranged if it was just dudes from Arkansas and Nebraska. No offense to Arkansas and Nebraska, but like Hollywood had its winning streak with this kind of ability for people of different kind of backgrounds to come together, and that kind of a more exciting, rarer mix in that kind of community was very much the key to the golden age of Hollywood being what it was. Like, I don't know what impact it had that Ernst Lubitsch and Billy Wilder, that they had this kind of a down-to-earth European cosmopolitanism that allowed them to be kind of strangers in America, looking at the American culture slightly archly, and to have this kind of curveball loving parodies of American and whatever. Like, that kind of tilting is what created the special situation in Billy Wilder movies and Ernst Lubitsch movies and whatever. So basically, like, if Finnish cinema is to somehow be more significant than it is now, then this is the formula that I think should be followed. Like, how did Hollywood get a Hungarian director or a German composer or an English actor and whatever? Like, sometimes it just happens when a film scene is rolling smoothly and whatever. But like, again, I feel like if the Finnish film scene tries to build itself exclusively by the local professionals that are already there, I just don't feel like there's a historical model. Like, you know, my top 100 French films list, I mean, Aki Kaurismäki was born in Finland, Raul Ruiz was born in Chile, Andrzej Sulawski was born in Poland, Krzysztof Kieslowski was born in Poland. I can't remember whether I had a Costa Gavras movie who was born in Greece, but like the French film industry can just very naturally pull international talent and have some sort of a melange there. And when French cinema was more exciting, they didn't just try to have you know, a couple of Parisians and a couple of guys from Marseille and one gentleman from Lyon and so on. They didn't just try to do that. They had the kind of you know, a wilder, more interesting melange. And I just don't think that Finland can have a prayer of reaching any kind of international art house significance, let alone mainstream significance, if it doesn't just rely on that kind of a pre-existing model that works. Like, we don't need to theorize about it. We can just go and look at the past. Like, look at an old Hollywood movie that just had guys from Nebraska and Arkansas, whereas one that had some of that European contribution. Look at an old French movie that had international ambience to it versus one that had just local stuff. And again, you realize just to what an extent there is an X factor to be able to kind of mix things up and create this kind of a special tonal situation that couldn't be arranged if it was just local boys doing standard operating procedures and whatever. So again, I feel like something like this is, when looking at historical models, looking at what has worked, looking at how things might work. And, you know, like Sidney Greenstreet and Conrad Veidt and Max Steiner, it's not as if those are necessarily the most obvious kinds of names that, oh, well, everything they're involved in has to become a classic and whatever. But, like, it's just a case of this kind of Langlois attitude of building, you know, to use modern parlance, an inclusive communal plane where one person creates significance and opportunities for other people and whatever. I feel like whether we can do it, I feel like that genuinely is the best strategy, and we can't get this kind of a Langlois type situation to happen without people genuinely making themselves about that life, investing, you know, making that all their life, and just trying to help connect one person to another, and to share knowledge, information, to help each other out, and so on. Like, I feel like that kind of Langlois-ness, like, it just needs to happen. Whether it can happen or not apparently remains to be seen. But like, I genuinely am a big time believer that this mentality, this stance, this angle is what, it's what's necessary, and it allows to connect the dots in a manner that is possible. But of course, the scope is grand, but you know, as I already told Henri, let's see what can happen, and hopefully this can be the beginning of a beautiful friendship or something, since I'm referencing Casablanca. But anyway, you know, just trying to make it official and clearing a few things out. But anyway, thank you for watching. That was all for this video. And if you like this video, I hope you'll like some of the earlier ones as well. But anyway, thanks for watching and bye-bye.